Bombay in 2010. He is also a certified energy auditor and manager of BEE since 2012. Dr. Deshmukh has been recognized as Young Scientist in 2012 by the Department of Science and Technology, DST, Government of India. He has 18 patents, 50 plus journal publications, and 30 conference proceedings to his credit, and holds an publication edge index of 301. His PhD work on 3D microfabrication system has received numerous accolades and recognition from IIT Bombay. Dr. Deshmukh's today's talk is also on the topic of microfabrication and its characterization, his area of expertise. Now I hand over the session to Dr. Suhas Deshmukh, sir. Welcome, Dr. Deshmukh.
Deshmukh sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, sir. Yeah. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Because of some mic issue, I think I have.
Yes, sir. You are audible now.
Yeah. Previously, I was not audible, and that's the reason it is seen as this. But here, I can't share my video because there is no meaning for it. Because my camera of laptop is not working. I can directly share my screen. That will be better. So thank you, Swamini Chopra, madam, for introducing me with all your participants. And I'm very much thankful to your principal, Santosh Bhosle sir, KJ sir, and all the organizers who has given me an opportunity to present my work, research work, at this particular conference. So can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So should I start?
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah. So once again, I thanks to all the organizers of Maharashtra Institute of Technology. And also I'm very much thankful to all to be a part of this particular event, faculty development program on advances in materials and manufacturing engineering, and organized by Mechanica Department of Maharashtra Institute of Technology, Aurangabad. So today I'm going to give a brief idea about this 3D microfabrication and characterization. So basically, so topic of your faculty development program is advances in materials and manufacturing engineering. But I'm going to cover not material part, but I'm going to concentrate on manufacturing part of it. And that to be also 3D, that is a stereolithography system manufacturing. And also I'm going to give a brief idea about how to do characterization at micro or MEMS level. And what are different characterization tools are available for micro scale for characterization purpose and this thing. So basically outline of the entire presentation is like this. So we'll first of all look at what does that 3D printing or 3D manufacturing means, and what does mean, what the origin of it, how that 3D printing or stereolithography system has initiated. And then I will discuss about how we are progress this stereolithography, micro stereolithography and 3D microfabrication. And then what kind of a testing we use what kind of a validation to prove what are the system we developed it at an utmost accuracy of manufacturing of 100 micron gear or kind of things. And then later on, I'm going to give a brief idea about different characterization tools, that is micro nano system, and how to do an analysis of this mechanical analysis, maybe a fluidic analysis kind of things. And we'll concentrate on very simple system, that is a scanning probe microscopy. And in that, I'm going to give a brief idea about how this atomic force microscopy works. And at the end, I'm going to give a brief idea about how this nanotechnology, nano indentation, will help us to characterize the materials at nanoscale. So basically, when we look into the manufacturing or fabrication of any system, so we follow three basic processes. One is subtractive, second is an additive, and third is a formative. So all these processes can be divided into these domains. One is subtractive, means we have a bulk of material and we are going to remove the material out of this bulk. That is what it is called as a subtraction of components from basic bulk material and creating your useful component, which is unwanted part you're going to remove from this. Under this, it comes up in a machining process, milling process, and drilling, planing process, then sieving, grinding, EDM process, water jet cutting machines, and so many processes. Another one is in a formative, where we are going to heat the component, or maybe under cold condition, we are going to give a shape for it by applying an amount of force to it. That is what it is called as a bending, forging, electromagnetic forming, plastic injection molding, all these comes under this formative type of process. Then third one is an additive, means we don't have as such initial material, but we are going to collect the material and producing the component out of it, maybe in a 3D, 2D, all this components. And that is what it is called as an additive. Under this, there is a most useful system, that is a CVD system, that is a vapor deposition systems. That is a chemical vapor deposition, then stereolithography systems, laser sintering, and powder processing. So if you look into the 3D printing or 3D prototyping, because it was started with the name of prototyping, not with a printing, in somewhere in 1984, somewhere by Mr. Hull, and he has initiated this process. So basically it starts with creating a CAD model, converting that CAD model into machine instructions by following certain mathematical process as well as computer process, electronic process, and you're going to manufacture the component out of it, and you're bringing back to your original component. And it involves so many steps, that is having a CAD model, STL file conversion, file transfer to the machine setup, building, removal, is unwanted, which are the part it is unwanted, like if you manufacture an O-ring structure, obviously you need to remove it. What are the component you decided for manufacturing an O-ranging component? That is what a removal process. Then post-processing, maybe finishing kind of an operations, you're going to do it. And you're going to directly, finally, final step will be an application of it. So if you look into this, what are the stereolithography process, which is developed in 1984. And anyway, I'm going to give a brief idea about brief history of this entire, how it has developed and what are the changes done till the date. So basically it was started within a CAD model, that is in a 3D CAD model. You created a CAD model using a computer. Then this CAD is further given to an ST. It is converted into stereolithographic file. So typically stereolithographic file means which are the surfaces in the CAD models are converted into a triangular faceted file. This surface is now converted into triangular faceted file. So this triangular faceted file is very useful in converting. Again, you're going to convert that STL file into having a multiple slicing layers, that you need to cut this into multiple slices, maybe 1,000 slices or maybe 100 slices, whichever it is depends on it. So that is what in a slicing file we can say. That is slice data you will get it. From each slice data, so you are now manufacturing this entire stuff or entire component by layer. I will now extract one layer, first layer, and then I will start scanning. When you are going to scan, scanning means there is a polymer in which you are going to expose the laser. So if you keep this polymer interaction, polymer means that is a photopolymer, and that property of the photopolymer is itself is a property when you are going to expose within a light, that liquid will be converted into solid. Liquid. Into solid components. That is what it does. So then you are going to manufacture one layer, then second layer, and then similarly you can go for multiple layers and kind of things. So when you are going to switch to one layer to second layer, what it happens, so you need to have a jet stage or some kind of a platform, build platform, which will now change the layer thickness. And this is what the animation, you can just look at it, how the laser scans in X and Y direction. And here are different subsystems involved into this and kind of things it happens. So this stereolithography system is proposed in first by Chuck Hall in 1984. Then he patented in 1986. And then this was brought into the market in 1988, that is known as a 3D, that is known by a company that is a 3D systems, who has marketed this as a stereolithography systems or RP machines, not as a 3D printers. Then 96, the word 3D printing is coined first time, and then it was not further converted into 3D printers. Up to 96, the scene was that liquid is basically used to convert into a solid part. And for that purpose, we keep in a laser interaction kind of things. And but in later on, it was decided instead of liquid, why cannot we use in a directly plastic and fuse that plastic within a heater, and further it will convert fuse by plastic pass through the nozzle, and that nozzle is going to spread on the layer, and then it is going to have on multiple layers like this. So that is what the way 3D printing we can execute it. So currently that 3D printer is used to have a multiple layer structured or 3D components manufacturing. So when we classify any of these RP machines, it will be classified into two, three different categories. One is liquid based RP machines. That where the liquid is basically used for converting liquid into solid part. So that is basically they follow on a process of polymerization, we can say. So initially it was started by a company that is a 3D systems, that is a stereolithography apparatus. Then Cubital, these are different companies have manufactured different type of systems based on the same RP techniques, that is a rapid prototyping system techniques. And they use in a liquid as in a basic material for it. Then only using in a liquid and using in a polymer for creating in a 3D component is not much more useful. That's what people have decided, why cannot we use in a solid component directly and manufacture it. So for that purpose, they use in a powder or kind of things. So which will be spread on the layer, each layer, and then the fusing process is carried out. Fusing means shining the laser onto this, that will pass the heat to these parts, and that will be fused, means multiple particles of this powder will be fused and created in a 3D component. So in that there are different type of technologies also you can observe. One is fused deposition modeling, then another one is laminated object manufacturing, then paper lamination technology, multi-jet modeling. So many things people have developed. Then another one is a powder, using a powder as in a base material. And then you want manufacturing RP components, that is a rapid prototyping component. So that is a laser sintering process where you are spreading the layer of the powder and then scanning the laser onto this, and then we are going to create a 3D component out of it. These are different companies through which they have entirely manufactured this RP machines, which uses powder as in a base material for this. So these are the few components. You can see it on the screen. So these components are manufactured using all these RP machines. So that is a different models, concept models, as well as useful models, which is typically used in jewelry making process. And this is what on a company, Nidhi CAD/CAM, which has maybe more than 5 to 10 such RP machines. When I visited in 2004 time. So during that, I observed these machines have a better accuracy, maybe in 100 microns accuracy, with a better scanning range and good amount of control of creating this 3D component. And so initially, when they want to manufacture a jewelries, they create a mold for it. And by using this entire process, and after creating a mold, they will pour that, but what are the metal you want to convert into jewelries, and then it is used to manufacture these jewelry parts or something. So basically, when you look into the basics of the stereolithography system, so basically stereolithography system involves so many components. One is basically currently that is a laser system, which takes on a laser and optical system, which will first of all focus the beam, that is beam generation system. Laser will be passed through multiple lenses and kind of things, and it will convert into a spot. So that is what on a spot, that is all. And then it is further scanned in X and Y direction like this. And that is what basically one basic subsystem is in a laser and optical system. And after that, you need in a liquid on which you need to shine this laser beam. That's what it is in a VAT system. That is a liquid polymer. And this liquid polymer is so designed that what are the laser intensity, laser maybe 351 nanometer, then it is a UV light. And according to this VAT system is used, that is the HDDA polymer and benzyl ethyl ether as in a photo initiator. And then that is what on a VAT means, that is what in a combination of these two will be used as in a polymer. And then this is given to the VAT, and then laser level adjustment, all these systems are there. That is what on a VAT system, you can say it. After this VAT system, then VAT to VAT system or polymer system, I can say, then next comes to be a platform where you are going to manufacture it. So that is, there may be an elevator where you can adjust the layer thickness and you can start manufacturing component layer by layer. That is what on a polymer system, platform system. And once one layer is finished, the next part is recode that for another layer manufacturing. That is what on a recoating, in which involves in one blade. So this type of blade is there. There is in a platform. You can just look at this platform. There is in a liquid will be sitting like this. And I want to remove this much part of liquid. So this part you want to remove, and this much you want to keep as in a perfect layer for it. And that is what the way this recoating system works. It involves blade, then resin delivery system, so many things will be there into this. And to control all these systems into a single way, then most important heart of it is called as a control system, which involves controlling the environment, maybe in a temperature, humidity kind of things, also light into that particular recoating system and VAT system, because light is in a major role it follows, because if you expose with that particular wavelength of light with this polymer, obviously it will convert into solidify, so may damage your manufacturing part. That's what environment part and light control system, that is temperature control. Then beam control means I want to control on a laser spot size as well as intensity in the spot. All these will be in a beam control system. And you need to provide multiple operations for this. That is what it is called as a process. So you want to have in a particular sequence, first layer, then second layer, what activities to be done in first layer, what activities to be done in second layer, third activity, third layer. Likewise, that entire process, that is what in a process control. And all this will complete as in a single subsystem, that is a control system. So all these involves, means all this control system will generate a signals for laser. It will generate a system signals for this resin level adjustment, generate a signal for platform system, recoating system, and all this. That is what the control system has. And combinedly, all these subsystems work synchronously to each other, and they will manufacture 3D component. So these are the typical components of your stereolithography system. It first comes upon a laser. This is what on a laser. Then comes upon a lenses through which you are going to condition the beam. Condition the beams means you are going to either focus it, collimate it, so many things. Sarji, there are then it is in a XY scanners, which will scan the what are the laser beam in X and Y direction. That is what in the scanning mirror system. Then laser beam, which will deliver the, and then you need to keep an interaction with this. This is a liquid polymer that is kept into the tank, and it is going to interact. If I keep this interaction very small, I will get in a smaller and smaller features. If I keep this interaction larger, obviously I will get in a larger size structures. And that is what the liquid polymer interaction and laser beam interaction creates in a and the laser beam, that is a liquid level, and so that it will adjust the layer thickness, and that is what. This is are the layered part which are typically manufactured onto this, and then build platform, which is taking care of holding the entire manufactured component into your liquid, that is a liquid polymer. So when we decided to develop this system, that is what we want to manufacture at a scale of resolution of 5 micron. But in market, when we started manufacturing, designing this system, a resolution is around about 100 micron to 50 micron somewhere. So that is what on a basically limitation of that. We want to reduce it to the 5 micron because we want to create a structure of micro size, micro, that's what it is, micro, it is called. You are manufacturing 3D component, that's what it is called, as a stereo. And you are using a technique that is to be written on the stones, that is what a litho, and writing technique, that's what it is called, as a graphic. So that's what it involves at least more than 4 words as in a single word. So micro, stereo, litho, and graphic. So initially the speed of the, when you are manufacturing within a very small scale and having a better accuracy, so in that case you can't get in a high speed manufacturing. And so that's what so limitation of what are the stereolithography system is, it is hardly 2 mm per second speed was there, and that is what on a limitation for this. And we want to come out of that limitation so that I can manufacture, we can manufacture with an very, very high speed components and kind of things. And the, what are the size is, what are the systems developed till the date or having a size of maybe in a 5 micron, 5 mm or 5 by 5 mm or something. So then that size is also, that range also we want to extend it. And that is what an 8 by 8 mm something. Then when we want to modify the system, which are the subsystems we have seen here. So out of that, then basically laser spot size decides what will be the feature size we are going to manufacture. That's what this system is playing in a very major role in manufacturing. Another one in this, there is a scanning system which will scan the laser beam. That is also very important because in case of mechanical scanning, we'll get an accuracy of 10 micron. But our spot is, we want an accuracy less than 5 micron. That's what, there are 2 systems to be modified. One is optical system, another is a mechanical scanning system. optical system will help us to deliver the focus spot of maybe a 10 micron or less than 10 micron. And in that particular spot, we are going to controlling the light intensity, and we make it in a different features by just controlling the light intensity. So that is what on a basically a theme. And another one, so we can observe there are different optical systems. I'm going to give a brief idea about what are the systems people, optical scanning system people have developed. So they will not provide an uniform spot size. They may change the spot during the scanning. They may change the intensity profile during the scanning. And that is what on a basically a limitation comes, because sometime your spot size is somewhere 5 micron, somewhere you are getting 50 micron or something. That is not anyway acceptable. That happens because of the way you scan it. That's what it is expected. Your spot characteristics should be uniform throughout the scanning range. And to get in a better accuracy of positioning of this spot onto the laser beam, onto the polymer. So what we expect is we need a high speed, highly accurate or highly positioning accurate scanning system, mechanical scanning system. So we'll now look at different systems, that laser beam delivery systems, which are typically used in stereolithography system. In stereolithography, you can just look at one as post-objective scanning system. Here it is in a lens is typically called as an objective, and you are going to pass the laser beam through it, and then you are going to have a scanning. Objective is this, and then after that you are going to have a scanner. That's what it is called as a post-objective. And this is typically used in a principle of Galeno mirror, which is typically used for measuring the voltages and kind of things. That is what use in all analog type of voltage and current measuring devices. The same kind of principle used to rotation. That is what rotation is used here. Is nothing but on a focus distance. That lens should have this has to travel this much, and it will now focus it. But whenever you are going to rotate, it will create a kind of a spherical surface onto the resonant surface. So as in a focus spot, these are all spherical points where the laser beam is having a focus point. But your resin surface is somewhere. I can just plot one thing onto this so that you can look at it. Okay, this is my resin surface, and this is my focal points. So when you hit this, so it has to move it to this much distance, and due to that, spot size will increase. And only one single point you will get an exact spot, and rest of the points you'll get a focus spot. And that will create here you will get a very large spot size, and here you will get a very small spot size. That is what it happens. And when your sizes may be 50 micron or 100 micron, that doesn't matter. But when you are manufacturing with an accuracy less than 5 micron or something, it will create a major change, or it will distort entire, it will generate an entirely and different structure which you are not expecting. Due to this defocusing of the laser spot, spot size is continuously changing. That is what it varies the spot size as well as intensity profile in the spots. It is creating a problem. And then they have decided to maintain this axis of laser beam and lens axis both aligned. And they want to move at this resin surface instead of this. When you are going to move this resin surface, and because These are, one is curve, having a curvature, and another is having an horizontal surface. And that's what, there is no possibility in such type of system which will maintain the focus everywhere. So here, because of that, when you are going to scan the resin surface, what will happen? It will create an waves under this. As you are going for an higher and higher speed, it will create more and more waves under this, and that will create a limitation in the fabrication speed. And also it will create a structure with the wavy microstructures. That is another limitation for photoreactor tank scanning. Then people have decided, oh, previously we are keeping the lens here and scanning it. Instead of that, we'll move the lens from this point to this point. That is what on a pre-objective. This is objective, and before that you're going to scan it. That's what it is called as a pre-objective. To remove this. This is what on a lens axis, and this is your laser axis. This will get an misalignment. And due to this misalignment, obviously, it will not create a spot size. Your spot may drastically change. And that is what another disadvantage, because of angular misalignment occurs whenever you are going to scan it. So similarly, there is one more system that is called as an off-axis scanning. Here also, the axis of this is going to off-axis, and that is again a limitation for it. And that's what, these optical systems are not much more useful when you want to manufacture at a scale of micro or nanoscale. And then we decided to just take some part of it and create a new system which will avoid this angular misalignment, and this off-axis misalignment. This I will give. Lens axis and laser beam should be aligned each and every point on the scanning location. And that is what it is called as an on-axis scanning. In this case, if you observe the scanning, the way we are decided to scan it, so if I scan in this fashion, the laser beam, and then mirror and lens, if I scan it linearly, axis of this laser beam and axis of lens aligns in one direction. And similarly, you can just have in other direction also. So this will, you will get an uniform or constant spot size and uniform in intensity profile. And that's what this uses in a linear scanning, and that's what it is called as an on-axis scanning also. Because you are maintaining the axis, that's what it is called as an on-axis scanning something. So based on this optical scheme, this is nothing but a typical optical scheme. Now we need to use this optical scheme into typical manufacturing of 3D component, and that is what it is to be. Entire scanning mechanism is to be developed around it. So for that purpose, we use this multiple mirrors, lens, and something. So when you are taking this laser spot from this point, it will hit to this mirror 4, mirror 3. Then it will come to the mirror 2, mirror 1, lens, and this resin surface, or focal plane, you can say. So it is expected that these mirrors have a fixed angle of rotation. That is what, a 45 degree angle of rotation, angle. And so they should be aligned at 45 degree. But most of the time, this doesn't happen, because in manufacturing, there will be an error, maybe a 0.1 degree also error will be there, maybe a 1 degree or something. If I decide to manufacture at 45 degree, maybe 45 something, maybe 46, 44, somewhere it will vary. And due to that, obviously there will be some misalignment always there in between lines. And that's what we developed on alignment technique. That I'm going to cover it in next part, in few couple of the slides. Then to achieve this type of scanning, there are kind of mechanisms which are to be serially mounted on one upon other. that is what on a serial mechanism we can say it. So that kind of on a serial mechanism also we designed it. That else I'm going to cover it. But before going for a direct mechanical design, so first of all, just verify what are the optical system we design, whether it really delivers the uniform spot characteristics or not. So that is what to be verified with theoretical way, and as well as some experimental setup is developed. So when we look into the polymerization process, this is what the Beer-Lambert's law. What this Beer-Lambert's law says, so if you have an intensity profile of the laser beam is like this, and if your polymer which you are using is having a critical curing energy level is this, what are the horizontal plane, you can see it. So you can observe there is no one after, if your intensity is more than this critical curing energy, this much component will get solidified. And if my spot size is something larger here, even though I will get an laser power or kind of things, or you can just use an optical switch which will vary the intensity. That is what it is called as a modulators. So that the equation of this, whatever the keyword part is given by this, and that is what defined by Beer-Lambert's law, which tells this is nothing but on a curing depth, curing width, and this is what on a curing depth. And what this shows on a focus spot size, that is what on a which involves wavelength of the laser beam, what is its focal length and diameter of the laser beam. So many things are there. So if you look into this, this is what on a, as according to your Beer-Lambert's law, this is what on a, in green line shows intensity profile, and this shows and keyword part. And actually, you are going to scan it. You are not only keeping the laser beam at one single point, but you are going to scan line by line. And once all the lines are finished on that layer, then you are going for a layer by layer. And that is what the in looping we do it. And this is what on a depth of the component achieved. That is what on a, then LW is the width of the component. And these lines are now joined by just scanning it and creating another 3D component. So then we decided to simulate this entire optical system, so maybe all the optical systems, and compare which are the system we decided to go for our stereolithography system. So for that purpose, there is any system involves input and output relations, and in whatever the relation input and output will have on a one parameter, one mathematical model, that is what we call as a transfer function. And in optical system, it is called as a PSF, that is a point spread function for optical system. So you are going to give the input as an intensity profile. You know the optical point spread system, point spread function of that particular optical system. Because point spread function means when you shine a light onto the laser beam, or laser beam onto the mirror, it will reflect at 45 degrees. When it is going to travel, there is a properties called as a divergence of the beam, intensity profile, spot size. All these plays in a very important role. When it is going to transfer from one place to another place, these properties are going to change it. And that is what are defined in this PSF. That is what point spread function, you can say. And that Oslo is one software we use for initial purpose for simulation of this. And when you combine these two, we'll get to know what are the output intensity profile at any plane, maybe in an image plane or any focal plane you want to put. So using this concept, we developed on a pre-objective scanner, a post-objective scanner, theoretically, that is what an op. Shape of intensity profile at focal plane, each and every place, each and every scanning system. Then we decided to compare all this, and you can just look at this comparison. When you this, what are the red color intensity profile? That is a C. I can say C indicates that is a pre-objective scanner. than this green indicates off-axis scanner, and what are this A indicates, that is what on a post-objective scanner, and blue color indicates, this blue color indicates our own proposed system, and that proposed system shows there is no variation from minus 4 mm displacement to plus 4 mm, which we decided as a scan range for this. It shows on a zero variation during the entire scanning. That is what on a basically advantage you can see theoretically. So same is with an intensity profile. As we scan the this intensity profile also shows on a zero change theoretically. The similarly, our this intensity profile should not change practically also. So these are theoretically you can observe it. So then we decided to use in a two systems we compared. One is pre-objective scanning we created into the optical using an optical table, optical components, mirrors, so many things. And then we use in a CCD camera to measure the intensity profile. And this shows in a simulation result. This is one simulation, this is one simulation. You can now look at the same kind of an experimental results here. This is what on a spread you can observe. Similar kind of a spread you can observe here also, pre-object. Means obviously, the what are the results we got theoretically, they somewhere match with the practical also. But here it is, you can just see in a blurring kind of things. The reason for blurring is because of the, whenever we take an image, it will compare with the background intensity also. And due to that, it will show a blurring. And if, and you can't practically create in a dark, truly I draw a dark room, and that's what it shows in a, this type of a variation. So if you observe practically how you are going to scan it, you can observe here it is in a very small variation in the spot size. So that is what in a very small variation compared to any other optical scanning system. Here also it shows in a very less intensity variation, hardly less than 0.1 or 0.2% variation in the spot size, spot characteristics. So that is what this optical system theoretically as well as experimentally, it shows these what are the proposed system will result into a better microstructures kind of things. So then we decided to analyze this misalignment, which I told you, if I change the orientation of this mirror, so this is my lens surface, and if I initially decided this mirror should be at 45 degree, but it is practically it is most of the time it doesn't possible. In that case, what it happens, this mirror may get in a misaligned by some angle. So it will create in a two types of misalignment. That is, one is an off-axis misalignment, and second is an angular misalignment. And due to that, it will change the spot characteristics. That small variation also will result into large variation when you are going to manufacture the structures at micro and nano scale. So then we decided to develop an optical scanning scheme. Is optical, we analyze this using an sensitivity analysis, you can say. So when you are going to provide an any of the misalignment of the any of the mirror, what is going to happen, how much amount of variation is there in final spot size. And if that variation is not much more, so obviously we can say, okay, this is a best system which is rigid enough to take care of the variation. And you can just observe, if you provide 2 degree variation also or 1 degree variation also, it is showing hardly 0.85% in the spot characteristics. And here it is in a here it is 1 degree variation, here it is in a 2 degree variation, 0.5 microscale. That's what this shows in a robustness of your our proposed scanning system. Then now come back to mechanical system. In mechanical system, you can observe there are multiple scanning mechanisms are available. You can go for piezo, spring-loaded mechanism, recirculating bar mechanism, and all this. In these all, you can observe when you are looking for a scanning range, if you go going for a piezo kind of a scanning, nano positioners, the range of the mechanism is hardly 1.8 nm. But in positioning resolution, you'll get into the nanometric scale. Speed is also very high. But here, basically, a problem with the range. We want the range with an 8 mm. But here, you are getting an only 1.8 mm. And there are spring-loaded mechanism which will give an, a large range, but lesser accuracy in the scanning. And better scanning speed also you can achieve it. So when you observe all these mechanisms, so basically, there isn't a trade-off all the time. There isn't a, when I want to get on a better positioning resolution, you will not get an appropriate scanning range and also maybe in some problem in the scanning speed. So that's what we decided to move to a new, entirely a new type of mechanism. That is what a flexural mechanism, I can say, which will take care of high speed also because it is a light in weight, large range also because it depends on how much amount of beams are going to deform and kind of things. That is what in a large range you can get it. It doesn't involve any frictional parts. There is no joints in between it. It is a entirely manufactured in single piece also. And so then it will provide you high precision, maybe in a nanometric precision also you get. So based on that, this is what in another mechanism which will we developed at, that is a scanning mechanism you can use it. Here you can observe there is a laser sources here. This is a laser. It passes through the optical switch. That is what it is called as a modulator. Then it will pass through the hole, then mirror one, two, then come to the three, four, and lens. And then it is in an X stage, Y stage, and it will scan it. And here you can just observe there is in a platform on which you want to manufacture the 3D. So these are the beams. These are the four beams which will take care of the motion in this direction. These are the four beams which will take care of motion in perpendicular direction. Or you can say it is an orthogonal direction kind of things. So this is what on a manufactured mechanism, because we took this to manufacture this mechanism to be manufactured maybe in, more than 8 to 10 months, because it involves so much of alignment, bending, so many things are there. Alignment is a major issue on this type of mechanism. So here you can observe there is an the actuators which will take care of motion, creating a motion in both directions, maybe in X and Y direction. Then we decided to just move on control part of it, because we are ready with your scanning mechanism, ready with an optical scanning scheme, you are ready with a bat and polymer and everything. But before going for an actual manufacturing, we need to ensure how much accuracy you can get in positioning. So for that purpose, we decided to scan only a circle with a circle within a 500 micron size. Then in X and Y direction, these are the signals you can get it. And based on that, you can observe there is an accuracy of scanning positioning is plus minus 1 micron. So later we also tuned up this parameters, that is KP, KD, KI, all these parameters. And we get an accuracy less than maybe in a 500 nanometer also, 500 to 300 to 500 nanometers accuracy we got it. 300 to 500 nanometers accuracy. In later stage, after tuning, we got better accuracy than this. Create a line by line scan. Means here I'm going to start the point and then I'm going to start the scanning in this fashion. So this will scan to this point and then this way I'm going to scan it. Here your spot size is this much. So it is going to scan, means it is creating a line like this, line of width. Then it is taking turn. Then another hole, it is, that hole I will say it is on a spot. It will start scanning on the overlapping scanning, you can say, and it will create one layer of the manufacturing. Once one layer is finished, then it will move to the next layer like this. So whatever the data from the CAD model is to be converted into X position, Y position, and Z position. These are the three parameters we need to create another third or fourth data is it is to be converted into this also, laser on off condition, whether I want to on the laser or off the laser. Then we compare that in a different scanning speed. It is observed you can get in a better accuracy even at a speed of 10 mm per second. So that is what in a beautifulness of the scanners, that is the flexural type of scanners into this. Then next task is to come to bring all these people into a single platform and let them work synchronously with each other so that it will create a 3D component. So here it is in a CAD model, then goes to the microcontroller. We use in a DSpace microcontroller. You can use any kind of microcontroller. Nowadays there are Arduino based microcontroller with a RAM boot coming to the market. Those are also sufficiently work, but only the thing is that what kind of a resolution you are looking, that matters a lot. So then it will generate a signal, analog signal. That's what digital to analog converter, one, two, these are there. These voltages plus minus 10 volt it will generate, and this plus minus 10 volt, and that don't have a sufficient amount of current. And that's what you need in a more current to drive these Y coil motors. So to convert that, you need a current amplifier, which will take on a voltage signal as an input, will convert into current, and it will give the signal to the Y coil motors. Then these are the optical scanning system. So there is a laser beam here. Laser will now generate a laser beam. Here it is an optical modulator, which will either change the intensity of the laser beam or also it changes the on and off also. But it has a better speed than any optical switch. So typically mechanical switch gives a switching frequency approximately around frequency or switching time. It is approximately somewhere maybe in a milliseconds. Optoelectrical switch it gives in somewhere in micro nanosecond switching speed. And if you go into the Acosta optical modulators, you will have a switching speed in nanoscale. This what are the Acosta optical modulator we use, so it switch the laser beam and on and off within 5 seconds of time. That is what an advantage of this. And also it varies the intensity by just providing another one signal to it, and it will change it. And that laser will come here, it will pass through multiple mirrors, then come to the jet stage. And jet stage is also monitored using an optical encoder. Here this, you can see ENC means it is optical encoder, which will have an one position, X position, Y position, and the short position. These optical encoder have a typical resolution of 20 nanometers, which we selected from Renisha. This is what an entirely, they do the work in synchronously. This is my CAD model, then convert into sliced information. After that, it will generate a scan path, means path generation it will generate. Then this path generation signal is given to the microcontroller. It will separate it out to the X position, Y position, laser on-off condition, Z position. All this will be done. So that is what it does. So this is typical picture of this stereolithography system. Which is, this is a laser, these are multiple mirrors, passes through the pinholes, then here it is in a XY mechanism, which will take the laser beam onto the platform. Here it is in a lens, and you can have a just look at the Z stage adjustment and all those things. So this is what on a typical video. And this is what an entire laser for it. This is the optical switch, which will on and off the laser, and also it will, these are the mirrors, and it will pass through this pinhole, which will separate out multiple beams into only one single beam. So you can just observe, this is UV light, that's what you can see it through whenever it is transferring from the air. Only blue color you can observe it. These are the mirrors. These are two mirrors, one mirror here and another mirror here. These are the screw which are typically used to provide an appropriate adjustment if it is not perfectly aligned. And Here it is in a, you can just observe a lens which will bring the laser beam onto this platform, and your component is going to manufacture at this platform. Then there is an adjustment here which will adjust the liquid level, and this is what on a stage, again it is a flexural type of stage which will maintain the positioning and Z direction with an accuracy of around about 20 nanometers. Here it is in a GUI, which is typically used to control each and every part of it, because in initial phase, you need to have a perfect control. Here it shows on a XY position, how much amount of progress is done and kind of things. Here you can look at the electronics stuff, maybe in a current amplifier, optical encoder, power supplies, RF drives. All these are now connected to each other. And the next task is to start manufacturing for this. So before manufacturing, it is expected that what exactly you want to manufacture it. And so initially we decided to only manufacture a very simple structure, that is water in a tank. Or you can just draw in a lines, kind of things you can do it. So here it is on a CAD model to multiple layers it is converted. That is a STL file, CAD model to STL file, STL file to this multiple slice layers. So this entire software is we developed at our IIT Bombay, and this Amit Fatak is one of the major contributor in this entire development. He has developed this entire programming, and he has to give me this data. And from this data, we are going to convert into scan path. This is the X position, this is Y position. You can take up separate one of the layer here, and you can just observe that laser is moving. What are the blue color indicates that laser points. And wherever it is in a white color indicates that indicates a laser is off kind of things. Then this scan path or path of each layer is again converted into X position, Y position, Z position is separately given to it. And then what is the laser, whether it is a laser is on and off, means laser is now starting here, on is up to this, and from this point is off. So that kind of a condition also should be there, which is to be given to the your optical switch, that is August optical modulator. Then this is what an entire GUI. In this GUI, you can observe there is a separate control for each and every stage is given. So reason for separate control means we don't want to interfere this. Means once I click and on, all the stages are running, but we most of the time when we do a research, initially we start with very simple cases. We should not start with any complicated case. So that's what to be treated individually first of all. So that's what we kept in a Y stage control separately, X stage control separately, laser on off condition. So here it is in a on off condition modulated, because complete 100% is not there, hardly 45 something it is kept it here. Then this shows an X and Y position at current stage. This shows an Z position. What is my Z position? Then this shows an how much amount of progress is done in single layer. Likewise, you can observe it. And we tuned up some parameters like what will be the modulator intensity, what will be the ratio of voltage, IOM voltage. What should be in, what kind of filters it is to be used, how amount of reduction of the intensity, what should be the speed, all these parameters are combined. And we've done a lot many experiments onto this, and ultimately came to some simple experiment. So I'll now show you a few of the slides here, and I will directly move towards the next part of it. So here you can just observe there is only one single lines, multiple lines are manufactured here. So then we tuned up this intensity, laser intensity, by either increasing the speed or decreasing the speed or providing multiple filters onto this and kind of things. And then it is observed so that you can manufacture a wire of approximately 5 micron width somewhere at 25 microwatt. If I still reduce this power, I'll get a few more precise wire width also. So typically 100 micron is our hair diameter, and we maybe in a 20 times lesser size wire we can manufacture. That is what you can observe here. Then we decided to manufacture in a multiple layers, that is in a single layer structure within a multiple lines. So this is what on a gear it is manufactured, having in a 650 micron diameter with 12 number of tapes and internal having in a width of this is 76 micron. Hard diameter is internal diameter is somewhere 100 micron and kind of things. Scan speed is it is 0.8 mm per second. And initially we kept it very low speed because when you have on a high speed, again you need to increase the intensity of the laser beam. That is one thing, and another one is you need to also look into one thing. Your scanning mechanism should have that much amount of disturbance reception, then it will help you to get. So then we observed the how much amount of dimensions it has impacted, and it is observed hardly 2% or to 5% variation in the dimension here. So similarly, you can now manufacture multiple layer structures. This is one layer, multiple, that is a variation you can observe into these all structures. So these are the scanning probe SEM images of all the whatever the structures we manufactured. So here it shows on a micropyramid, here it shows on a microcones, then scaffolding structures, maybe on some fascinating structures like this. So a few more structures. Then here it is, you can observe microchannel, which is overall dimension is 4 mm size, and channel dimensions are 146 micrometer, and reservoir is in 1740 microns and kind of things. And you can just observe here, you can quite easily manufacture this structures with a better and better accuracy. If you have a perfect control over its speed, perfect control over your intensity of the laser beam and kind of things. Though after my PhD, one of our my colleague, he has continued his PhD work, and then he decided to change the intensity to get the needles, micro needles, and then he manufactured a micro needles in this fashion. And this micro needle having a width at the tip, you can get hardly 5 micron or less than 5 micron. And these micro needles can be used for biomedical applications. And similarly, he has manufactured in a radial direction, that is axisymmetric structures and overhanging structures also. So this is all for manufacturing. And if you have any questions, I would like to be happy to take some questions, and then we'll move towards the next part of it. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. So one of our faculty have collected few questions, and I will ask him to ask it to you. So just give me 1 minute, sir.
Okay. And one more thing, sir. How much time is left for me?
Sir, it is now, I guess, 11:32. So you have more 20 minutes.
Okay. I will give a brief idea about it.
Yes.
Characterization. So I will take up one or two questions, and then we'll move towards the remaining part.
Yes, sir. So I request Kazi sir to unmute, and please you can ask the questions. Kazi sir.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning, sir. So myself, Professor Kazi from Mechanical Department. Some of the questions from the participants. The questions are, number one, what is the software used for XY mechanism and slicing?
So actually, we here in our serial lithography system, we never used a software. We developed our own code, which will take in a CAD model from in STL file format. And that STL file format file is further sliced using mathematical equations and so many things. That is what it is done by Mr. Meet Hartak, who has M-Tech guy. and he supported it a lot. We together sit and then we developed an entire MATLAB programming for it. Any other?
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, hello, am I audible, sir?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes, sir. So the next question is, what is the smallest possible size of one spot or one voxel created by the laser? That is, in other words, what is the resolution of the 3D printing?
Yeah, I can show you one slide here. You can just observe. So here it is in a hardly 20 micron spot size there. It is in a, you can just observe 20 micron, 20 to 30 micron. But the smallest part you can observe here, it is in a 5 micron or less than 5 micron somewhere. So we initially decided to go for a spot size of 5 micron of whichever the lens we are using it. That is what on a basically thing. And later we change the lenses and we increase the size and decrease the size also. So the spot size is 5 micron and voxel size we achieved is somewhere it is of 2-3 micron as a, at the tip, and base size is 5 micron somewhere. Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So can we take one more question?
Yeah, you can.
So the next question is, one of the participants is asking that, as mentioned in the photo of reactor tank scanning, that wavy microstructures are generated. So does this type of microstructures are helpful in achieving better property? And if yes, then how?
Yeah, actually there are different ways, because see, we done it on experiments on converting liquid into solidification. So that is what we followed in a steel lithography process. Okay, so we use in a basic standard polymer. That way we decided to use. So that polymer has in a certain own its property. If you want to improve on the property of this microstructures, you can do one thing. You can include ceramic particles. You can embed some nanoparticles sure you want it in later stage. Or also you can change the polymer, maybe on your photo initiator, monomer, combination you can change. You can change the properties of those structures quite easily. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So, sir, we can move to the progress in this session.
Yeah. So, next part of my presentation is on a typical characterization systems, which is used for characterizing the stops and micro and nano scales. So, I'm going to concentrate on typically mechanical measurements like in a deformation, deflection, vibration analysis. This is it is typically equipment is used as in a micro map. So, and also laser Doppler vibrometer, which we know it. And I'm not going to give a light onto this laser Doppler vibrometer, but I'm going to give a light onto this micro map. Then also you want to analyze this micro channel flow. So that's what most of the time we need in an experimental setup. That is micro PIV system is used. And then next is texture and topography, that is scanning probe microscopes and kind of things. We are going to give this and how to determine this properties at nano scale, that is nano indentation. One simple example I'm going to give you, and that is what we are going to process. So MicroMap is in a device which will typically non-contact type measurement of the deformation pattern, vibration pattern, anything. So typically, this is what an equipment which is having, this is a laser system which will take the laser using an optical fiber, and it will be shined onto this specimen. So this specimen is around about 500 micron size or kind of things. So maybe in a cantilever beam or kind of things. So pass through the lens, maybe call it as an using it. When there is an experience, you can observe there is in a dark and white such bands. You can observe here the huge pattern onto the beam. And by just moving this beam, what will happen? These fringe pattern also change their location, because and that is what in it is a typical technique is called as in a spiccle pattern interferometry, which will tell you the deformation pattern and everything. And in this, once you have taken an image, here there is a camera images, high speed, and that will show you the deformation pattern quite easily. Here it is on a pressure diaphragm, or you can just pressure sensor that is analyzed into this. In this pressure diaphragm, there is, you can see a ring type of fringe pattern here. And this ring type of pattern are further converted into deformation pattern. Bring out using this micro map device. Next is in a micro PIV system, which will take care of determining flow pattern into the micro channels or any micro structure when you are going to send in a liquid through it. So that is what on a thing. So here it is in a syringe pump through which you are going to send in a liquid, and then it will pass through the micro channel, and it will outlet will come out here. So here it is in a 30 micron size and 300 micron length micro channel is mounted at here. And then in this, whenever you are passing in a liquid through the micro channel, there are certain fluorescence particles are also embedded or mixed into this liquid. So basically this PIV means particle imaging velocity meter. The same principle we used in fluid mechanics to determine dye technique. That is what in a dye technique it is called. In this dye technique, we provide in a dye into the liquid and we want to observe it. And that observation will tell you whether your flow is laminar, whether your flow is turbulent or kind of thing, or transition flow or something. Same technique is used, but here instead of dye, now nanoparticles having a property of fluorescence that is sent through it. And here it is NDAG laser, pulse laser is used. Here it is on a laser beam, which will shine these particles through this microscopic lens. This is what on a laser, it will go to this. And then what are the images? Both the images means your laser beam. This is a beam splitter or filter, you can see it. So it will bring it, and there is a CCD camera, which will have in a very high speed scanning speed. Means per second, maybe scanning 100 or 1000 images per second. And it will store onto this, and later you can convert that multiple images into a video. You can see an entire video pattern, how this micro channel is now going to vary this. That is what you can do it. So here, once you determined all the images, you need to pass through the multiple images, multiple processes like sampling, quantization, enhancing, reducing the noise. So many things, software calculations, we do it. And then we'll come up with a result, and that is what a typical flow pattern you can observe it here. Here it is, you can observe a flow pattern here. Here also you can see in a flow pattern, which is this, what are the color shows. Here the flow of dense flow you can observe, it is in a less flow, uniform flow. Like based on that, you can go on determining what will be in a heat transfer coefficient and so many other parameters of the flow pattern. So that way you can do it. So next part is in a scanning tunneling microscope, which is typically used to determine the topography of whatever the component we manufactured at micro nano scale. So in tunneling means it is going to create a current in the tunneling. So whenever you look the component at very micro scale, so there comes up in a limitation of all optical microscopes. So that limitation is called as an Rayleigh limit. So beyond certain dimension, you can't look at. So reason for this, so when you are using a wavelength of 700 nanometer as an optical wavelength, and you want to observe the microstructure of a size less than 1.4 micron, you can't do it. That is what the limitation it is told. So to avoid this, so they have developed on a system which is used for scanning purpose. And these are the atoms you can observe it, and these are the surfaces, which is any surface cannot be in 100% uniform. You can't get an 100% flat surface. So obviously, so this type of variation is there. You want to observe how much amount of variation is there. So for that purpose, there is a probe, and there is in a metal particles or this, what are the sample, it is downward part, you can see it. So then voltage is applied across these two ends, but there is no connection in between it. So when you can just observe this animation, you can just look at it here. So there is a distance between this is to be kept in appropriate distance, maybe a nanometric distance. And when you are going to scan this, so what it happens as distance changes, so current passing through this particular is going to change. That is what in a tunneling voltage you are going to apply, and the current will now start scanning. And it will now show you the deformation pattern onto the screen. And that way one line is scanned, and similarly in stereolithography, we are going to scan in multiple lines. And similar fashion, you can go get a 3D structure quite easily using STM type of devices. In these devices, you can observe one thing. You can use only when you want to pass on a tunneling voltage. Your sample should be conductive one. If you are using in a plastic samples or something, you can't get a tunneling current, and obviously that will create a problem. And that's what this has in a limitation. It can only use for a structure of an what it is called conducting parts. So this is what an basically a mode of operation through which you can get an STM. There are two types of operations through which you can do an STM. One is in a constant current mode. You are keeping the current fixed and you are measuring the height. So that is what in a constant current mode. And another one is in constant height. I want to maintain the height of this pole, and then you're going to observe how much current is going to vary. So that is what on a constant height. These two will be used, depends on the what type of surface you are using for a scanning purpose at atomic scale. So then these are the few images through which you can observe it. These three images are created on the what are the deposition, mica deposition, C60 film on mica deposition. It is shown it here. So similarly, you can observe these colors are just based on the height, not with the that sample itself. So 7 nanometer by 7 nanometer size here, 7 nanometer this side, 7 nanometer this side. And you can observe each and every atom separately using this STM type of devices. But limitation on these STM devices, your sample should be conductive. So same way, you can just look at the comb drive actuator here. Then there is a chemical processes also. I'm not going to give a light onto this. This is what a probe which you are using for probing and scanning purpose. Having a 2 micron tip size, 1 micron tip size kind of things. So next comes up when there is a limitation on STM is material should be an electrically conductor material. And when you want to use an insulator, it becomes difficult. That's what there is another setup is called as an atomic force microscopy is developed. In atomic force microscopy, there is each and everyone knows that when you are going to have two atoms, so this is one atom and this is my second atom, it will maintain this. An attractive force. This is what a stable distance between these two atoms. And if you maintain that particular tip on the surface of any sample of with this distance, obviously it will that is nothing but a stable condition. So obviously this is what your sample having some variation in the structure. And this is what on a tip it is mounted within a certain, that is an optical distance, or you can say it is an atomic distance. And it will, whenever you are going to scan this sample and this direction, what will happen? This tip will now move in this direction. So this will up and down, it will continuously move it. And then later you can mount on a deflection sensor of nanometric scale and you can quite easily measure it. And here it is, you can go on line by line scanning and kind of things. And this is what a basically principle for atomic force microscopy. This is the guy who does the work at atomic level. It can show you atomic atoms separately and kind of things. And this is what a controller which will control all the XY scanning, cantilever beam adjustment and all this. And this is what a control computer and monitor on which you can observe the pattern which it is deposited on the sample surface. So this is what an it is key components for it. Ten micron by 10 micron, maybe 100 micron by 100 micron, maybe 500 micron, like this. And it uses one technique. It is a photo quadrature photo detector as a displacement detector. So that's what you can just observe it. A plus B, and these are the ABCD are four quadrant into a quadrature photo detector. If you look into the quadrature photo detector, it is four quadrant like this. So if you are going to shine the laser beam onto this, so this is my A quadrant, this is B quadrant, then C quadrant, and then it is in a D quadrant. So you can now observe how much amount of intensity is there on this quadrature, and based on that you can determine what will be the position, what will be the tip deflection it was happening. So this is what in a typical different techniques to determine the cantilever deflection, because you are not allowed to touch it. Once you touching, means that cantilever it is an STM probe is shined onto this, and it will maintain this distance as the STM is needed, and you can go on sampling it. There is another one. There is one is called as a photo detector. So here it is a typical technique. It's used. Having in a four quadrants, and spot is going to shine onto this. The location of spot is depends on how much exposure they got it into all the four quadrants. That is what in a technique is called as in a optical amplification. And last one is in a capacitance technique. And so you can maintain two plates, and then distance between these depends on what kind of voltage or charge it is collected onto this. So this is what a typical picture you can just observe. Here it is in a cantilever beam laser. Tips on which you can observe. This is what in a tip of 2 micron size. It is here 10 micron size. Here it is in a 5 micron size. These are different tips typically used to scan or determine topography of the micro or nano structures for different cases. Then there are here also there are two modes of operation. One is called as a contact mode, where you are going to bring this cantilever tip in contact with the sample surface, and then you are going to scan it, and then cantilever is going to deform. This deformation is detected by this photo detector. Then detector electronics is there, which will determine the deformation pattern and kind of things. The another mode is in a tapping mode, when you are using in a component with a very adhesive type of property. So there is a possibility that cantilever may get stuck with the sample itself and it will break it. To avoid such a difficulty, so this cantilever beam is now vibrated, so within a particular speed. So using in a piezo patch. Here it is, a piezo patch is mounted, and then it is going to continuously vibrate, and due to this vibration it will not get stuck into the component, and that's what it is called as a tapping. They are all the time tapping on the sample. That is what it does. So this is what in a tapping it does. You can just observe the sample is vibrating and kind of things. Yeah, so then this is typically used for adhesive type of structures, maybe in a plastic with more adhesive kind of things, maybe in a high amount of friction in the surface or kind of things, or maybe on a soft surfaces it is used for scanning. So this is what on a next last part is nano indentation. Indentation is in a technique which is typically used for determining the material property at nano scale. In this nano scale, so when you create an indent onto this, how much amount of indent and how much amount of force you have applied on it. So based on that, in mechanical way, we determine in a BHN, that is a Brinell hardness number or Rockwell number or something. The same technique is used in nanoscale also, but it also gives on a stress-strain curve completely. That is what it does. So for that purpose, this diamond probe is used. Here it is in a diamond probe and having in a 60 degree angle. This is kind of in a pyramid type of structure. And this diamond probe is now inserted onto the sample within a certain force. And that force monitoring can be done by using piezo patches mounted at the base of your cantilever beam. And this is what in a polymer structure before indentation. After indentation, you can just observe there is in a black spot. This is what an indentation can. And this indentation, during this indentation, you can go on collecting the how much amount of force it is generated, how much amount of deflection it was happened. And you can get the typical graph of this. You can just observe. This is what a graph of a stress strain curve. And then you can observe in three different phases. One is elastic limit. Within elastic limit, you can observe this. If you go into the plastic limit, it observes this. And this is nothing but a kind of a failure you can get. And this is further can be converted into stress strain curve because it is a force upon area gives me stress, deflection upon total length gives me a strain. It can be converted quite easily, stress strain curve at nano scale. That is what the way you can do it. So I'm very much thankful to these people, Professor Gandhi, Kundu, Joshi sir, who has given a very nice opportunity to work in this lab, that is Suman Mashruwala lab. And then my colleagues, Kiran Bole, Amit Patak, Rahul Ramtekwar, there are only I put a few names, but there are huge from mind. If you have any questions, you can ask. Sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Just a minute. I will ask our faculty to ask the question. Kazi sir, can you please unmute yourself?
Hello. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So some of the questions from the participants that were remaining from the first half of this session. That will be continuing. One of the question is the liquid optional, which is used for hardening purpose?
Basically, liquid means whichever the liquid we are using in stereolithography. It is a combination of monomer and photoinitiator. Photoinitiator, what it does, it will collect the light in terms of photons. And that light converted, that photoinitiator will convert light component into an radicals, and then it will now start joining the single molecules of monomer into a polymers, and that will convert that liquid into solid. That is what it does. So whichever the properties, means if you take a separately monomer and shine in light, it will not work anything. If I take a photoinitiator only collect the light and generate the radicals. So you can now plan in a combination of these two. Means you can now have a monomer separately, then photoinitiator, which is taking in a light in a particular wavelength. Means whatever the liquid we used, a photoinitiator is 351 nanometers. That is a BE. If you select another photoinitiator, which will absorb at a normal visible light also, that is also works. And based on that, you can now tune up on a property, you can go on selecting in a different liquids, different photo initiators and manufacture it. This is what it you can do it. And if you want to enhance the property, like you want to increase the strength, you want to provide a better flexibility or kind of things, you can now think of to include enough nanoparticles into this. Maybe in a ceramic nanoparticles you can include, you may be including in a cobalt nanoparticles, and you can enhance it, because a lot of people have done in a research on doing an including doing on combination of this liquid polymer and this nanoparticle combinations. So this is what I can answer. Next question.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. So the next, hello.
Yeah, bola.
Hello. So the next question is, what industries are into 3D printing and how is the development in this sector now?
So 3D printing means it can be, see, in 3D printing, people have developed on structures which can be manufactured using a metal also, because that is what development is currently going on. In future, if you want to have a micro and nano kind of structures, so there is one more technique is left to explore by most of the researcher that I can show you, I can tell you, that is what it is called as a two photon lithography kind of a technique, which will manufacture the structure within a nano scale, nano mechanism you can quite easily manufacture. So that is what it is, still it is left to research. And nowadays you can observe 3D printers are such that these 3D printers are very easily available. You can get this 3D printer hardly 50,000 or something. Basically, when you look into this 3D printer, the thing is that whenever, whichever the material you are using as in a raw material for it, it is used as in a plastic. So some people have thought it, why cannot be used in a waste paper? And parchment, waste paper. And this waste paper also will be one of the way you can use in a raw material, and based on that, you can manufacture 3D components. Yeah, next question.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, how much is the cost range for manufacturing of MEMS?
So actually, currently this MEMS component manufacturing cost is very huge, because it is not yet commercialized, and so processes are not streamlined as per industry part. So I can't tell you exact cost, because which are the stereolithography we use, because it involves so many factors. Material cost is not the only thing. Which are the process cost, what kind of components you are manufacturing, what is the size you are looking, that depends on all this cost. Because I guess still it is in research domain, few of the components people allow commercialize it. But we can't comment anything what will be the cost, but it is a huge, I can tell you, in current state. So as these processes will get more and more commercialized or more industrial oriented, then this cost may reduce to a few rupees or kind of things. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So one of the question is, nano indentation can be used for calculating elastic modulus. Also, does this property value matters while manufacturing newer materials?
Yes, sure. Because which are the material you are manufacturing? You may be using any kind of a process, like in a CVD process, maybe in a, you can go on doing an indentation. You that property you can quite easily determine. So it is, that is what the way you can do an nano indentation. There is one more technique by which you can do it. So there is one technique, it's called as a molecular dynamics. So where the each and every molecule is modeled mathematically onto the computer using an equations and kind of things, you can create a plate of it. You can now think of to provide a theoretically nano indentation or determine the property of it. So it will depends on how much amount of force between these molecules and kind of things. That way also you can do the good amount of work if you don't have any actual setup to work on it. Yeah. Next.
Thank you, sir. So one or two more questions are, yeah. What is the scope of this technique from business point of view?
Yeah. So when, see, business point of view means you can develop such type of setup and you can think of to manufacture kind of an sensors. You can think of to manufacture kind of an actuators using these techniques. Actuator, so also you can manufacture maybe some kind of a shape memory alloys, maybe a kind of a sensor structure, polymer based this pressure sensors, kind of things, and you can think up to be in a business in this particular regard. Next.
Thank you, sir. So one of the question from the team is, can property evaluation by nano-indentation help evaluate microstructure-wise property instead of bulk property? Say the difference between martensite and bainite properties in steel.
So that is typically, we went to the metal side. Actually, nano-indentation will help you to determine the property at a nano scale and micro scale. When you want to determine a property at an average scale, like we may be using in a testing this indentation, simple indentation technique or UTM technique, UTM machine we are using to determine stress strain curve. So for that purpose, if you are going to scale it in this nano indentation will be much more helpful to determine all the property. But in case of martensite and whatever you told it, I don't much aware about it. So you can explore on maybe a few research paper people might have done on this kind of a work, because I done it very preliminary work on nano.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
So the last question which we'll be taking is, what is the most critical component developed in this field?
So I can say it is on a micro motors, and some people have developed on a drug delivery system. Drug delivery means it is in micro scale. There is in a some patient may have an prone to heart attack. So in that case, that heart attack will be sensed by some sensor, that is heart. There is in a liquid which will be secreted before 2-3 hours. This heart attack. So that liquid is contains some antigens, and these antigens will be going to be stuck under the cantilever beam. That cantilever beam is going to deform, which is going to generate a signal. That signal is given to the micro pump. Micro pump will take a drug from the tank, and then it is delivered into the your liquid, and your heart attack may be prolonged or may be avoided. So this type of system is typically developed, and people still working on it because it cannot be at commercialized. So this is one typical application I can tell you. One more, because I worked on this heart attack sensor, because it is very difficult to manufacture very small scale kind of devices, and also it needs so much of process involvement, so much of cleanliness, so many things it needs, because whichever we are going to manufacture, it is in clean rooms, not a normal place you can manufacture it. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. So this will be the end of the question answer session.
Yeah.
So
thank you. Thank you all for listening for me from maybe a 1.5 hours period. Thank you to principal, entire organization team, KJ sir, Kaji sir, and Trishil Kulkarni sir, and all people who was involved in this entire organizing the event. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Hello.
Haan, bola, sir.
After enjoying a highly enlightening session full of knowledge and emerging ideas on the topic of 3D microfabrication and its characterization, I'm obliged here to have this opportunity as a member of the organizing committee of this technical symposium, AMME 2020, to express my sincere thanks to the session expert today, Dr. Suhas Deshmukh sir, Associate Professor, Government College of Engineering, Karad. I'm quite sure that this session would really help promote further research and new explorations in the area of microfabrications and characterization. Again, in addition to the excellent execution of presentation on the topic, what I personally found more interesting about the session was the way The session expert today, Dr. Suhash Deshmukh sir, elaborated each topic supported with examples until I think it is completely understood by the participants. I express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Suhash Deshmukh sir for answering again a host of questions raised by our participants. We'd really want to again and again hear from you, sir, from more such topics in the near future. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Yes, over to Trishul.
Thank you, sir. Here are a few instructions for the participants. The link of afternoon session has been posted on mail. So you please go through your mails. The link will be available there and also on WhatsApp group.
So here on we'll end the session by the permission of the chair. And hello, am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Kadi, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So there is an instruction for participants. The link for the second session is available on your mail and also on WhatsApp group. So please join the session by 12:45 and please join the session on the time. So we will not may not permit you if you become too late. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you. So here we declare that the session is ended.
Sir, please again give the time of session, second session.
1 p.m.
Yes, to all the participants, the next session will start sharply at 1 p.m. So it's advised to all the participants to join at least 10 to 15 minutes prior to the start of the session. Also, your valuable feedback is needed for each and every session. So after the end of session, the feedback link will also be shared in the WhatsApp group, which has been set up for this AMME 2020. So thank you. Thanks a lot, all of you. Yeah.